Thank you. While we do a little shifting around to bring up the panel, because it is a there are a lot of people here this evening who were really key to the actual making of the film, and I want to take a second, if you will help me, to thank them. First of all, I want to start with Andrew Finstone, who you actually saw in the film. He's out at Boise State, and Andrew was the one who actually called me up first and said, "Hey, Martin, would you ever think about making a film on Reinhold Niebuhr?" Andrew, would you stand up? I think they like your idea, huh? Also here tonight from Harvard Divinity School, we have one of the consultants, too, who's here, Helen Gaston. Helen, would you stand up? And Jeremy Sabella, who's been really a wonderful consultant to me, and he's the author of the companion book to the film. Jeremy, would you stand up, please? One of the other producers for the film, Jen Quintana. Jen is here, and she takes over the website. Jen, are you here? Stand up, Jen. Max Kasanovich, who's here too, and he's been helping with all. We're doing 25 events with this film all across the country, and Max is coordinating all of that. So, and really, a dear friend, Anthony Bellissimo, did all the graphic. Didn't you love the graphics work and that touch that it had? Anthony, would you stand up? Anthony's here. There he is. And we do a lot of our own historical research, but one of the people who was a really critical help for me, Cecile K. Richter. Cecile, would you stand up? Hiding under here. When you tell Cecile, "I need a picture of this," she'll spend a month looking for that one picture. She's just a great blessing to all. The voice of John Dancy in the film, my good friend, Jerry Coates. Jerry, would you stand up? There he is. And our sound man, Joey Diaz. Joey? Hope I didn't. Yeah, there's Joe. So I hope I didn't miss anybody. But thank you for thanking them. It means a lot to me. Thank you, Mike.
Dave. We have a distinguished panel to just begin to think about the implications of this powerful film. The moderator is Mike McCurry. He is best known as the press secretary to President Bill Clinton from 1995 to 98, and more recently as co-chair of the Commission on Presidential Debates. He began his political career as press secretary to the Committee on Labor and Human Resources, then press secretary to Senator Harrison Williams and Daniel Patrick Moynihan. A graduate of Princeton and Georgetown, he then rose to a different level of public service and took a degree here at Wesley Seminary. He is now our distinguished professor of political theology, and he is the executive director of our Center for Public Theology. Mike?
Thank you. I've got my distinguished panel here, but there's so much to talk about, I'm going to introduce them only briefly by calling them up to the stage. You've got in your program at your place a lot more about their biographies, and certainly you can read more about their all their accomplishments. But let me invite them to come up, and we'll just get going right away. Dr. Josiah Young, who is a professor of systematic theology at Wesley Seminary. E.J. Dionne, who is a syndicated columnist for the Washington Post, senior fellow at the Brookings Institution, who by being here you're not seeing on the NewsHour tonight. The Reverend Dr. Carolyn Davis, who is the newly appointed Director of Strategic Development at the Public Religion Research Institute. And more recently, my valued colleague at the Center for Public Theology, and Gustav Niebuhr, the professor of journalism and religion at Syracuse University, a former religion writer for the New York Times, and the grandnephew of Reinhold Niebuhr. I'm going to be asking those panelists to comment on the in a moment on the film, and then we'll have Martin, who's already been introduced, to respond. Before I do that, Gustav, let me, just on behalf of all of us, express some condolences to you on the loss of your father very recently. In a long tradition in that family, he was also a very distinguished public theologian. And we know that by being here, you're honoring his memory too. So thank you for being with us. Let me just go straight to the most important question. Of all the things that each of us could say about Reinhold Niebuhr. What do you think is the impression that this film leaves you with the most? What's the takeaway from this film that probably makes the greatest impression on you? And given all of you have got familiarity with Reinhold Niebuhr, do you think it's the right takeaway? Let's start down. We'll just go right up the end. I'll start with you.
Thank you very much, Mike. The one thing that stands out for me about the movie is that Reinhold Niebuhr displayed some ambivalence toward African-American struggle for human and civil rights. His refusal to sign the petition that Dr. King presented him with, that Martin King presented him with, a petition that would have pressured President Eisenhower to intervene on behalf of those in the Southland who were fighting against segregation, was very telling, certainly very disappointing to Dr. King. Cornel West, in the documentary, pointed out that Reinhold Niebuhr had been reading the conservative theories of Edmund Burke at the time, and perhaps that has something to do with his reluctance to get on board. Gary Dorian said something to the effect of Niebuhr being somewhat naive about the depths, the structural depths of anti-black racism in the United States. They may be right, and certainly their criticisms take nothing away from the greatness of Reinhold Niebuhr. But I'd like to share just a little bit about Niebuhr's history in that regard. He wrote an essay in 1956 about what was going on in the Southland and emphasized with white Americans who were apprehensive about blacks integrating their schools by saying that that the cultural differences between the two races are still great enough to warrant a certain amount of disquiet on the part of the parents. And I wondered in reading that what Reinhold Niebuhr meant by cultural differences. And I also asked myself, assuming that he was talking to white parents, what's wrong with black culture? And we find this ambivalence in his legacy from the time he was in Detroit at the Bethel congregation. On the one hand, he championed justice for blacks. On the other hand, he sympathized with whites who were reluctant to have blacks live next door to them, because he felt that blacks had been so crippled by slavery and so crushed by what they experienced in the North during the Great Migrations that in many respects we were an underpar people. At Bethel, he left Bethel, and when he went to Union, there was a conflict in the church about admitting black members to Bethel, and Reinhold Niebuhr did not support the blacks. And that's interesting development, or interesting incident in his life. Richard Fox who is one of Niebuhr's highly regarded biographers, writes that Niebuhr lived on the border of the black ghetto of Harlem for 30 years before he began to understand the character of racism in New York. And I wonder, why did it take him that long? And if he were alive today, what would he say? And what do we learn from Niebuhr in this regard?
EJ, we need to kind of keep moving along.
Sure,
EJ, what's your takeaway?
Well, two things. First of all, I feel like saying I was so moved by Martin's film that I'm kind of speechless, but you can't say that when you're on a panel. So I just wanted to thank him for that. And there were two things that hit me that I didn't fully grasp about Niebuhr before I saw the film and should have. One is what Dr. Young talked about, which is I didn't understand that early reluctance on race, on civil rights, because I'd always associated him with Heschel, who was such a powerful ally of civil rights. The other thing I never knew is the time he spent on an FBI list, which is ironic because Niebuhr was one of the leading anti-communists in the country. He founded Americans for Democratic Action because it was an organization of anti-communist liberals. But in the larger sense, and one of the reasons I really like the film is I think that you conveyed, and I think this was, you really got this from Cornel West and Gary Dorian and our distinguished Harvard historian here. You know, liberalism corrected by original sin and a sense of human frailty, it's the cliche about Niebuhr, but I think like some cliches, it's true. It was, you know, that a liberalism with too much confidence in human nature would be insufficiently vigilant against injustice and autocracy. It would lack the humility that all who have grand plans and great hopes need to embrace. And that's probably why he was drawn some to Burke, because there is a kind of humility in Burke. And that kind of liberalism would give up hope in the face of the inevitable difficulties that human frailty causes. And I think that you can see why Obama is a Niebuhrite and can fairly claim it because of the way he talks about hope. And it's very Niebuhrian, like the prayers, that hope isn't blind optimism, Obama would say. Hope is sticking with it, knowing eventually that you can win even in the face of great setbacks. And I think that sense of Niebuhr came through very powerfully in the film, and I think that's always a lesson to us.
Your observation, by the way, on Niebuhr being in the FBI files for so long, Martin made a sly reference to this, and the audience may not have picked up on this, but it's been revealed today in some reporting that's been done that the current director of the FBI, James Comey, has a private Twitter account in which his handle is Reinhold Niebuhr.
And so I think he wrote a thesis on
Reinhold Niebuhr. As an undergraduate at the College of William and Mary, he did his thesis on that. So that's
now, what would Niebuhr say about the last 2 weeks of the last election?
We'll get to that in a moment. Caroline Davis, your thoughts.
Well, first, I just want to say thank you for the opportunity to be here, and thank you for this wonderful film. I was a theology student not too long ago, and I remember being... So I'm United Methodist, and in our tradition, we carry this profound hope that with enough hard work and piety, we all become like Jesus, and it's a beautiful idea. And yet, I remember being struck in school. A professor came into an office where a few of us were seated and announced out of nowhere, he said, "There's got to be a better word for it. Total depravity just isn't enough." This was 2005, probably. I'm not sure what was going on in 2005. That hadn't been going on for a while in human history. But I remember being struck by that idea, and I remember when I came to Niebuhr in my theological work being equally struck by a willingness to confront the profound tragedy of human nature and the sort of deep longing that humans carry, that characterizes all that we do. So that so much of how we engage one another and interact with one another is so already shaded by our woundedness, our hopes, that thing just out of reach. And I think I would share with Niebuhr a concern for the sort of latter days of liberal Christianity's failure often to take that more seriously. And I think the film in particular, there's a moment where they talk about that tragic nature and that reach back to Augustine that I find so powerful. And yet Niebuhr is also often criticized for emphasizing that very dark sense of human being and the focus on the human individual as needing to deal with that thing. And he's criticized for being less attentive to what one can get and learn about oneself in human community, that there is a potential in human community for a kind of transcendence that is a good. And so what I was also struck by is in the film, especially in the latter half of his life, the way that you use the role of friendship as you talked about his evolution in theological thinking, so that his friendships with his wife Ursula, with Rabbi Heschel, with Paul Tillich are critical to the way he asks his ethical questions. And there's a humanity there, and I think a wonderful contextualization of his work with the very sort of horrors of the 20th century that is also enlightened by the joys of personal friendship. And I thank you for that.
Gustav, that sense of humanity is a personal one for you because it's a familial relationship. But what's your takeaway on watching that film and the idea that it leaves you with most?
Well, I've had the very good experience of seeing the documentary twice now. And so I get to thank Martin Doblmeier twice very much for his work, which is it's important to me as someone who cares deeply about American Protestant history, but of course as someone who is within the Niebuhr family. I would like to respond in particular, I wasn't thinking about this as much as E.J. got me thinking about it when you use that phrase, sticking with it. And that happened to be a phrase often used, or a suggestion, maybe even commandment, often used by Reinhold's father, Gustav, after whom I'm named. And that was something that I think Reinhold had instilled in his life in a way that it's unusual in that one doesn't hear that as a command, as something as dogma, but instead as an encouragement to be brave and also to be honest, and to be honest about being able to move from one position to another and acknowledge it too, as Martin tells us in the film. Let me add something here too. Speaking of the family, I think it's important to acknowledge how important certain people were who may not get quite the credit that they should. And that is the women in Reinhold's life. He was the son of a pastor's wife, a pastor's daughter, Lydia Niebuhr, who really knew how to run things in terms of a local congregation. A very important figure. She lived until 1960 or 61. Also, of course, Ursula Keppel Compton, who married Reinhold in 1931, is an extraordinary person in her own right, and someone who, that marriage, I think, had a great deal to do with lifting him to the place where he could write and could think and could create as he did. And I would add, too, the influence late in his life of his wonderful daughter, Elizabeth Sifton, who's quoted in the movie. There are these sort of the people around him who are very important, I think, in shaping him, and I think one shouldn't think of him as a person who's incapable then of continuing change throughout his life and continuing responding to the people who bring ideas to him and to the necessities of responding to the times in which he lived, which were extremely perilous and varied.
Martin, you've now had the opportunity to show this film to a number of audiences, and what in the responses that you've heard, and just heard some here from the panel, what's the most surprising thing that you've heard people take away from this? Are they getting from this film the impression that you hope to leave?
Well, I don't, am I on? I don't just say it. Can you hear me? Yes? I don't just say this because you're here, Mike, but the truth of the matter is this question that I wanted to raise about the whole notion of public theology. I mean, Reinhold Niebuhr was the great public theologian of the 20th century, and night after night, the film, sort of somewhere along the line in the conversation, we turn to, well, what is that idea now about public theology? How do we think about that? And are there public theologians today? And I think one of the things that I reflect on is that we're here at the museum, and how different it is today in the 21st century, 2017, from Reinhold's day in terms of media. When Reinhold Niebuhr was at the pinnacle of his game, his national popularity, his international popularity, the media was such a different creature than it is in the 21st century, that there were a handful of major television networks, radio networks, a handful of major publications, and if they loved you, you wound up on the cover or you wound up being featured, just like Mike Wallace interviews him on primetime television. Today, the media is a very different animal, and it's so diverse that if you tell me where you get your news, I can probably tell you what you're thinking. And we generally go to the kind of news sources that reaffirm our thinking already, as opposed to challenge it and give it a different kind of dimension. The problem for the whole idea of raising up a public theologian in the 21st century would be, how do you cut through all of that? And how do you sort of galvanize those different kind of media platforms to be able to actually become a unified voice of the same kind of way that Reinhold
Niebuhr could ask? I wanted to ask Martin a question on that, because I've thought for a long time that Reinhold Niebuhr couldn't be Reinhold Niebuhr today. And it's for a number of different reasons. One, I mean, he would still be smart. He'd still write great books. He'd still have insights that we ought to learn from. And yet, you know, how often has Time magazine, or its equivalent now, put theologians on the cover? Whereas at that period, Tillich was on there, Bart. Niebuhr.
What they put on the cover is truth dead? Just right. Like they put, is God dead in the 1960s?
But you've got to go all the way up to truth or God to get there, as opposed to one of us humble human beings. You know?
Right.
It's also the voice of public Protestantism. Protestantism had a huge public role in a way it doesn't now. And in a way, the marginalization at times of religion, either as primarily private or primarily associated with the right. I'm just curious. I'd ask anybody here, could Niebuhr be Niebuhr? And for that matter, could Dr. King be Dr. King in the same way that he was? That's what I wanted to ask.
That was my next question anyhow. So panel, respond.
Well, I would just jump in and say, I think one of the big differences that you're mentioning, EJ, is the whole notion of religious literacy within the world of journalism, the way things are covered. I think the major publications and the news wanted to have a voice, like EJ said, that could speak and use language and sort of metaphoric language like grace and forgiveness and redemption that was so commonly spoken on Saturdays or Sundays in your place of worship. And I don't think there's a religious literacy in the world of journalism like it was back then. And I don't think, given the demographics that I'm seeing, and maybe Carolyn can talk to that, I just don't see the religious literacy the same way that it was then now.
By the way, I want to say Gus Niebuhr was has been one heck of a religion reporter.
Well, that's what I would. Yes.
Thanks,
Gustav. That's your. This might be your neck of the woods. Yes.
Carolyn, please come in after this. But one of the things is, yes, there is a certain amount of religious illiteracy. Well, a lot of religious illiteracy present in 21st century America, and even in late 20th century America, which I vividly remember. But the key to dealing with that, and I think Reinhold was really very good at this, is to speak in an accessible way. Not dumbing it down by any means, but by being able to speak from the heart, from the intellect, in a way that communicates directly with people to whom one wants to speak. And he did that. He was able to do that. He never looked down in terms of, gee, I've got to really reduce this. But that's the key, I think. That really is the key. And that's why one of the reasons that, for crying out loud, I am not as pessimistic as almost everybody I know about the future of mainline Protestantism. Because I do find people within that sphere who are able to speak in a way that communicates directly with men and women who need so to be spoken to that way. Please.
I think that, I hear what you're saying, but at the same time, I think that part of our dilemma politically today has something to do with the role religion played, Protestant religion played in this last election. And the cover that you mentioned, Mike, from Time magazine is Truth Dead? I mean, it's a very, very serious question given this time of alternate facts. And I think that one of the great things about Reinhold Niebuhr is that he was committed to telling the truth as he saw it in a substantive way. And we're missing that today. And I shudder to think of what the consequences will be for our nation and the world if religious folk are timid and afraid to emulate the prophetic example of a Reinhold Niebuhr.
And particularly at a moment like this. Carolyn, let me bring you in. Sure. Chime in.
So I've been thinking about this question all day. And one of the things that struck me, I was rereading The Irony of American History this morning, and he's writing about these conflicts between nation states. And so much around the ethical questions around foreign policy, around partisan affiliation, grow out of this concern with vast national threats. And the contrast between that sense of what an American identity, false or not, under the illusions of innocence or not, the way that that operates in juxtaposition with, at the time, the Cold War, before that, the questions of entry into various total wars, that there was a discernible sense of an enemy that was identifiable, that had boundaries and borders. And we think today now about trying to navigate ethical questions of conflict, foreign and domestic, that don't involve nation states anymore, but do involve often the manufacturing of other kinds of monoliths, so radical Islam or folks dependent on entitlements that are bringing down the national economy, or these different kinds of manufactured threats the media plays a role in. A lack of literacy contributes to the buy-in to, but also other kinds of cultural anxieties. And you pair that with the diffuseness of how we get our information. I just spent a week talking with young people about how they engage media. Do they trust media? No. But are they happy to let Snapchat give them the news? Absolutely. So this diffuseness of how we absorb information, this diffuseness of what we what gives us anxiety, and therefore then also I think the diffuseness of moral voices in that space. You know, can there be a singular voice in a space where everything else is plural? And I'm not sure.
Let me ask you a question, kind of picking up on that. You know, Niebuhr, we reference always the influence he had on politicians. That's part of that Martin is in the film. But do we have people who are having that kind of impact on our debate today? I mean, it's hard for me to kind of think of who's out there who does have that. And that the contest, actually, the contest between the Billy Graham voice, and we are very familiar with the impact that he had on a number of our presidents and politicians. The contrast with someone like Niebuhr, who's raising much larger issues about society generally and where it's headed and what needs to happen, even though he was himself engaged in the political enterprise as well through the ADA and other things. But, you know, what are the examples of how that plays out today? I mean, I was thinking about that in terms of this panel, and I'm thinking, well, where are those examples now? Any Niebuhrian inspiration out there?
Well, I think that there are. I mean, I don't know how well covered they are, but I think of someone like Reverend William Barber in North Carolina.
Yes. Four Mondays.
Yes.
Very articulate, very sharp, a public intellectual. And I also think persons like Cornel West are vitally important. He's an extraordinarily well-read person, very prophetic in his way, and a very humane person. So yes, I think that there are. Jim Wallace is another example of someone who's been on the front line for a very long time. So they're out there, but I wish they were exposed more. You know.
I think you're absolutely right about that, and you also threw down a glove in a very good way in your earlier remarks, and that is that we can't or. The religious leaders in this country can't afford to be timid. And the test of that, I think, is coming soon.
Amen.
Because there's been an onslaught against the news media, as we well know. And the new powers that be, I think, at some point are going to turn on the churches and synagogues of this country, too. Because I think that's part of accomplishing a broader program of removing certain centers of authority or moral authority from the discussion.
Yes.
And this is a very good time, particularly if one thinks those centers are weakened, to come after them. It's been done in other countries, it's been done before.
Yes.
EJ, would you comment on that? Because that you hear that discussion often, that this is a dark period here. There's not much reflection in the media about some of the true danger that we might face as civil society if it starts coming apart because of the polarization, the bitterness. And you actually, one of the few who write about that. But to pick up on Martin's point, is this a problem of the media, the media collectively, I know is hard to describe, but your compatriots in the world of journalism, do they just not get some of what the religious, moral, issues are that we're facing? Is it a question of religious literacy in the media that they're not picking up on some of these larger questions of how we form a moral society when we maybe are a little bit immoral?
Well, I guess there are two things. One is I share your list very much. I once had to be on a talk back-to-back with Reverend Barber, and I said the definition of life being unfair is having to speak either before or after William Barber. By the way, just a nominee for someone who does not have wide attention, but I think is one of the most Niebuhrian writers we have now, is Kathy Cavaney up at Boston College, who recently wrote a wonderful book, which is so Niebuhrian, called Prophecy Without Contempt. And she argued that the most important prophets have humility, and that, and this is sure relevant to the moment, that we need social humility regarding the status of other peoples, including one's enemies, in God's affections. And I think that, I think there are voices out there. Let me be the glass one-tenth full person here, because I think both on the media and on the seriousness of the country,
yes, I know.
The result of the election was a wake-up call. And I think you're seeing a kind of moral seriousness in the media. And my colleagues may not be steeped in theology. I'm not sure how many journalists ever were steeped in theology, although there were always more around. Ken Briggs, the religion editor of the New York Times, I used to say was the sort of secret confessor to journalists who go to the back of the room where he was. And it turned out there are a whole lot more journalists with religious interest and imagination than anybody knew. But I think there's a kind of moral seriousness in the media, because I think there's a realization about what their job is, about what the potential threat that you're talking about is, and a real sense of mission. And I think there's a realization in the country. I think that a whole lot of Americans got a lesson that public engagement really, really matters. And you're seeing it out there now. And the paradox is that if the last election was a product of a sort of democracy that wasn't working, the reaction to that election may be what is needed to make democracy work, which is a sense of public engagement of the sort that Niebuhr recommended his whole life.
Yeah, and I think Niebuhr would agree with me in saying that one of the most dangerous projects that we can now undertake is nostalgia.
Yes.
If amen. Only we had more prolific white preachers on the cover of Time to tell me, right, like how to frame my morality. Not that I'm not grateful to every one of them that landed on the cover. Maybe not Tillich, but that's what. So I think as well we have to. Part of the project will be particularly for I don't want to use older generations, but generations of folks who have been in leadership for a long time, is part of the work, the moral project of learning to listen differently to who will be coming up into this space. So millennials break down somewhere in the 18 to 36 year old range. So most folks in middle management, most folks who will soon assume middling spaces in government and authority and politics and everywhere else are millennials now, still, technically. And so this is now. And the plurality of ways that millennials engage with one another makes me think about the way that we have to learn to listen to where millennials are digging down and finding moral, ethical vocabularies for the activism that they are undertaking. So today is the Transgender Day of Visibility, and Sarah McBride, the press secretary for Human Rights Campaign, for instance, is also a devoted Presbyterian. And if you listen to her speak, you will often hear in her words her deep faith formation. Folks like Bree Newsom, folks like Malala Yousaf are all reaching down deep into the roots of their ethical formations as folks who grew up with a sense of justice and who now have a vocabulary for articulating it. And it doesn't sound like Niebuhr. And it isn't formed in the halls often of divinity schools, although more and more, as many divinity school students in here wave, the work that they're doing and the work that's bringing many of them to seminary now, we know, is to come and do social justice work.
So maybe that expression of faith in the public square that we're in becomes a little less furtive.
I think it's going to be less furtive, and I think it's going to be a little bit more in your face about the issues of the day and require a level of uncomfortable listening and space making.
Well, that might be, yes, that might be the example that Niebuhr gives all of us. I am told, speaking of the glass being 1/10 full, our glasses are ready to be full at the reception that we're about to have. But I want to give everyone a chance, if you've got a parting thought before we go off to wine and dine ourselves, anything that you would like to say. And Martin, I'll give you the last word. We'll give anybody else.
I just want to thank Martin for putting together such a powerful documentary.
Yes.
And I can't wait to see what your next project is.
I can't wait for it either. So.
Let's see, Bonhoeffer. And
forgiveness. We did the
Niebuhr. Yeah, forgiveness.
Power Wasp put on a heck of a show in that. It was. I just want to share a couple of Niebuhrisms and thank Martin for a great film. You know, the last person in the world ever to preach humility is a newspaper columnist. But I think that the Niebuhr's theological case for humility in so many spheres was really powerful. And just so I want to close with two Niebuhr quotes. He said, "Some of the greatest perils to democracy arise from the fanaticism of moral idealists who are not conscious of the corruption of self-interest." And he also said, "A nation with an inordinate degree of political power is doubly tempted to exceed the bounds of historical possibilities if it is informed by an idealism which does not understand the limits of man's wisdom and volition. And I think politics always needs to be tempered by humility, and rarely is.
I'd say I loved that you opened with Niebuhr's quote about morality making democracy possible.
And yeah, I love that too.
Yes, you know, and immorality making it absolutely necessary. Yeah. And I think it's such a trenchant sentiment for the time. And I think this movie has me thinking a lot about the way that we have to recapture the idea that even it's going to be far more plural than we ever experienced before, but that fostering moral imagination, individual work around moral courage, it needs to kind of come back to the fore as part of the project of citizenship, however we come to understand that, but it is so critical.
And part of that too is reclaiming the word citizen, which is so important to our country, to being an American. I want to just come back to something that you said before. You're talking about the millennials. Mm-hmm. And I think that actually jibes with the question that's been asked, could there be another Reinhold Niebuhr? There may be many. The spirit of the best of Reinhold Niebuhr may be embodied, we can only hope, in a mass of people, in just, that's what I'm trying to say, in many, many different committed people, such as the ones who've shown up here, not of late, on the Mall. There's something hopeful about that.
Absolutely. Martin, you get the last word.
Oh, well, it's not fair. I feel like what's been the great privilege for me in the making of the film is that night after night, now all across the country, I get the privilege of being on panels with folks like this, and I feel like the mongrel among the thoroughbreds, as Niebuhr would have said. I remember so clearly on the morning after the election, I thought to myself, I'm not sure what this means for America, but I think it might be good for the film.
That was excellent.
And night after night, all across the country, we've had these kinds of conversations, and I think we all benefit from it. I know I certainly do.
I have the serenity of knowing that I can't change the time that the panel was supposed to end and the reception was supposed to begin. So let me thank the panel. Please thank our panel for having their time with us.